Hey everyone, I'm Mike Dean, monster movie and Godzilla movie enthusiast, and this is The Dean's List. On the show, I'll be reviewing monster movies, comedy movies, action movies, horror flicks, you name it. And today's review is a very special one because today I'll be going over my personal top 10 favorite movies from 2017 since we're approaching award season. And just to let you know, there may be just a tad bit of spoilers, so you've been warned. The film that will take the number 10 spot is Star Wars: The Last Jedi. Star Wars The Last Jedi, to me, in my opinion, is one of the best Star Wars films ever. Right next to The Empire Strikes Back, because it's original. And a long-running franchise that's full of, you know, amazing fights, amazing choreography, amazing visuals, this one really stands out because it takes you to a place that you didn't expect. I mean, fans had their speculations about what Luke was gonna end up doing, about what Rey was gonna end up doing, what was gonna happen to the other side characters, and especially what was gonna happen to Snoke and Kylo Ren. But they just did a total 360 and flipped it out. And some fans are really disappointed. You should check the backlash, which is really unwarranted. And then a lot of other people, for the most part, like me, liked it. I thought it was amazing. It was full of great action, great fighting sequences. The acting was top notch. And not to mention that ending. I'll just say the ending with Luke Skywalker is amazing. I'm not going to spoil it that much because those who haven't seen it, please check it out. You don't know what you're missing. That's all I'm going to say. The film that will take the number 9 spot on this list is Baby Driver. And I'll tell you why. Because Baby Driver, to me, is like the modern day Blues Brothers. Okay, now before I get any backlash for that, just hear me out. The way the music and the action sequences just coalesce and work with each other like a delicious ice cream chocolate vanilla swirl is just amazing. I adore it. The action, the acting, the romance, and even, might I say, the laughs are amazing. And the story about, you know, about like a getaway driver who runs these big heists for an even bigger, badder guy. I mean, that's been played out to death, but the way this does it, it's almost musical. It's not a musical, but the way the music, the soundtrack, and the gunplay plays out, it's really different. It's a different movie for something that's been done over and over again. And Ansel Elgort really, really shines, and so does Lily James and John Hamm, and not to mention Jamie Foxx. Jamie Foxx really surprised me because when I first saw the movie, when I first saw the trailer, I thought Jamie Foxx was gonna be like the cool sidekick character, but then he turns out to be a total jerk. The guy turns out to be evil. Like, absolutely just malicious, like a wild animal. And it really takes you for a loop the entire way through. And Baby Driver really was one of the best films of 2017. It just was. Just colorful, vibrant, full of action, and full of laughs. Baby Driver really does make the Dean's List. The film that'll take the number 8 spot on this list is Kong Skull Island. What to say about this remarkable, remarkable movie? The visuals are stunning. Let me just start off with that, which is exactly why it's being nominated for an Oscar for Best Visual Effects, which it deserves to win for anyway. And not to mention the setting. A monster movie set during the Vietnam era. Talk about original. That's never been done before, especially with the helicopter sequences at the beginning when Kong fights off the helicopters. I think that whole scene is a slap in the face to the planes killing Kong in the original King Kong movies. Because honestly, Kong, for such a great monster, Kong doesn't need to die. And this is totally just a slap in the face to all those other movies. And this is pretty much, like, Kong Skull Island is pretty much saying, yeah, I've died long enough. It's time for me to actually win in the end and live on. So I'm just happy it does that. And it's just the whole thing is legendary, which is exactly why Legendary Studios produced Kong Skull Island, because the movie's freaking legendary. It's just, out of all the Kongs throughout history, from the 1933 one up until now, this Kong truly seems like a mythical legend, like the Kong of myth. Because while Kong 1933 is a great movie, he still seems like a regular animal. And he's killed like a regular animal. And in Peter Jackson's version of Kong, the island around Kong seemed legendary, but Kong himself didn't seem legendary because Peter Jackson reduced him to nothing more than just an oversized silverback gorilla. There didn't seem really anything mythological about him, and that was quite tragic. But in this one, he fights off these amazing monsters called the Skull Crawlers. There's all kinds of other cool beasts on Skull Island, and the natives on the island, rather than savages, they're peaceful, which is really original. We're not here to see the natives attack the main characters. We're here to see the monsters attack the main characters, which Kong Skull Island focuses on. And the characters in the movie are great. Samuel L. Jackson does great in everything he does, as well as John Goodman. Tom Hiddleston is a great hero. Brie Larson is a wonderful love interest. And all the other side characters do their job well. Everyone acts great. The visuals are great. The action is great. And like I said before, Kong doesn't die, which also adds another original mark to this film. So, Kong Skull Island, it deserves to win the Oscar, and it deserves a place on this list. One of the best monster movies ever made, and I stand to that. The number 7 spot will be taken up by Three Billboards Outside of Ebbing, Missouri. This movie is depressing. It's sad and rather tragic. And yet, at the same time, it's hilarious as hell. Like, seriously, it is funny. Like, how can a film combine all this tragedy with all this comedy? If you could pull that off, you really do have talent as a filmmaker and as an artist. Frances McDormand plays the mother of a girl who was killed by a rapist, and she finds these three billboards on the outskirts of town to, you know, advertise and bring recognition to the town and help find her daughter's murderer. And then, you know, antics ensue, you know, more scandals come out into the light, a detective case is opened up, and it just leads to an entire dramatic adventure. And it really is stunning. It's brutal, it's dark, and yet it's funny. Frances McDormand delivers, Sam Rockwell is amazing, and Woody Harrelson is just amazing. Woody Harrelson could do anything. And we just have other cast members who are extremely talented, and I'm really hoping this movie takes home some Oscars because it deserves it. It's a great drama, a great comedy, just a great film all around. Totally unforgettable. I check it out. I would check it out again and again and again. The film that'll take the number 6 spot on this list is Logan. Logan truly is one of the best superhero movies ever made. It's dark, it's brooding, it's sinister, and it's full of action. And most importantly, it's the way we've been wanting to see Wolverine for a very, very long time, since the X-Men franchise was started. He's brutal, he's world-weary, he's battle-hardened, and it's just, he's tired of it all. He's wanting to die. He wants to die like he's been his entire life, and you can clearly tell it here, but you could tell that he still has a mission, that he still feels like there's purpose in his life, especially when this little girl with the same powers that he has comes along, and now he has to get her to safety along with Professor X. Patrick Wilson is amazing. He truly plays the old mentor that still has a lot of regret on his heart due to things in his past, and Logan is still torn up about things, you know, maybe losing Jean, maybe losing all of his friends, maybe how things have become this apocalyptic nightmare. But amongst all that gloom, there's still a lot of fun to be had. There's action, there's intense violence, it's like a Western. It's like an old school spaghetti Western. And Logan truly does deliver in every sense of the word. For a hard R action flick, Logan really shines. And it's a shame that this is the last time we'll see Hugh Jackman as Wolverine. I mean, I could be wrong. I mean, with 20th Century Fox being bought by Disney, who knows? He may show up with the Avengers. We don't know what possibilities may lie ahead. But as it stands right now, it was the last time, and this was a very good adieu and goodbye. Logan deserves a place on this list. And it deserves the Oscar for Best Adapted Screenplay. It really does. The movie that'll take the number 5 spot on this list is The Shape of Water. Oh my good goodness. This movie is remarkable. It is the best romance movie that I've ever seen because it adds in the science fiction fantasy aspect, you know, with the gill creature. It has the He has even more fantasy elements with the girl who's mute and can't speak. Like they say at the beginning of the movie, the princess without voice, which really adds to it. And the whole movie has a beautiful visual art direction flair that's just, it always has this greenish, bluish tint over it, which makes it seem like you're being under the water. In a way, it's therapeutic. In a way, it's eerie, but at the same time, it's beautiful. And you could truly tell that Sally Hawkins is really feeling the movie because she truly has love for this creature, and the creature has love for her. In a way, it makes her, it makes her transcend into like this beautiful maiden who's longing for love, like Rapunzel. And this fish creature, who's a lot like the creature from the Black Lagoon but more benevolent, is looking for love too, which makes the creature human. And Michael Shannon shines as the villain. He's the standout performance in this movie. Just how raw and uncaring and how cruel he is. You see how determined he is, but it's for evil purposes, just to kill and maim and hurt, and how perverted he is, how racist he is. This movie shows the love that human beings can accomplish and the hate that human beings are capable of. It's Guillermo del Toro's most mature film. I mean, in his other movies like Hellboy, Blade 2, Pacific Rim, they all have like a childlike sense of wonder, you know, with superheroes, action, big giant monsters, robots and aliens fighting to the death for the conquest of the world. But this one, it deals with themes like, you know, being different, you know, sex, love, romance, you know, accepting people for who they are despite their differences, appreciating those differences. And that's what Shape of Water represents. And for that, it's a masterpiece. Shape of Water is one of the best films ever made. I love it, I adore it. I've seen it 5 times, and I'm probably gonna see it many more. So Shape of Water, one hell of a good movie. The fourth film on this list is John Wick 2. What can I say about this over-the-top action spectacle? It's one hell of a great sequel. Because after the first John Wick, I didn't think it could be topped. The action, the stunts, the firepower, Keanu Reeves as this silent warrior who's just going around all around New York, just hunting down the people that wronged him, was just brutal and relentless. I didn't think they were gonna top it. So when I heard news of a John Wick 2, I'm all like, yeah, see, now they're overstaying their welcome. This is gonna end up like another dumb action sequel that might as well have been direct to video. But like a lot of the times, I'm wrong. Because John Wick 2 truly is one of the best action sequels ever. I know I keep on saying that, like, oh, this film's one of the greatest ever, this one is, but it just truly is. I can't help it. I mean, they actually show the pencil trick. They actually show how John Wick could take on how many ever other guys with a pencil? A freaking pencil. Just like that. And it's just amazing. And with Common in it, and just Lawrence Fishburne, which has this, like, this mini reunion with Keanu Reeves and Lawrence Fishburne. It's like Neo and Morpheus meeting together again after all these years. It's just amazing seeing all this just coalesce into this one great actioner, and it still holds up as a great sequel. And I can't wait to see what they could do. I just can't wait to see what they're gonna do with John Wick 3 and the proposed TV show about the Continental Hotel. And it's just, it's amazing all that has yet to be seen. John Wick 2 is amazing. Keanu Reeves is amazing. I can't wait to see what's next. The third film on this list is Christopher Nolan's Dunkirk, his World War II epic. This movie is a masterpiece. Just a masterpiece of sight and sound. The cinematography is enthralling. When you feel like you're in the middle of the ocean, that's because of the great cinematography. When you feel like you're actually on the beach with those soldiers waiting to be picked up and taken home, you feel like you're actually on the beach. And when those gunshots go off from the ships and the planes, you feel every single blast. And the music, which is nothing but just these tick-tock sounds of the clock hands just moving and ticking, because time is of the essence. Tension is building. The Nazis could come in any minute and just start blowing all of them away. And it's just, like I said, it's enthralling. For a war movie that has no blood, no guts, no gore, and still manages to develop that kind of tension and terror, really says something about Christopher Nolan as not just as a director, but as a visual artist. Because the beach, the sky, the air, everything about that film feels a cold sense of dread. The sky is always gray and cold. The beach, the waves, the crashings, the sound, the performances, it's just tension. War films usually like to show the violence of war. Dunkirk shows the tension of war, the pure, raw tension. Sometimes the tension could be more painful than death itself, and that's what Dunkirk captures, and that's why it makes this list. Dunkirk, I love you. It's amazing. The second film on this list is a special one, and it's The Disaster Artist with James Franco and his brother Dave Franco. This movie is about, you know, Tommy Wiseau. He wants to make a film because he can't find a job as an actor because, honestly, he just sucks. So then he decides to make his own movie with his buddy Greg, and it leads to a bunch of hilarious hijinks. The Disaster Artist truly shows, no matter if you fail or succeed, there will always be a silver lining. Because you could actually work hard and have talent, or you could just suck and still fail so spectacularly, you still end up getting what you wanted. Because in the end, that's what Tommy Wiseau got. He got what he wanted. The fame, the fortune, the re-releases, the anniversaries, and ultimately, a Golden Globe win! Because James Franco does such an amazing job as capturing the eccentricity and the insanity and the mad genius of Tommy Wiseau. It just leaps off the screen. You think you're watching Tommy Wiseau play himself. It's that great. And the side characters are great. Dave Franco shines as Greg Sestero. Like, just his angst, his fear, his frustration, but at the same time, his fascination with Tommy. I don't doubt anything that happened. Everything that happened in this movie, I sure don't doubt. Because if a movie like The Room could exist, and how crazy and how uneven that is, then the story about the making of The Room would have to be honest. It would have to be honest truth. So, there it is. The Disaster Artist really is just one of those one-of-a-kind movies. It's the Ed Wood of the 21st century. It's amazing. It's hilarious. It's funny. It's a little dramatic, but overall, just it's a big comedy bash, and one of the best true stories ever told on film. I love it. Check it out. Check it out before it leaves the theaters. You don't know what you're missing if you haven't seen it already. And now for the number one film on this list. This was a tough one, but after some digging, I find that Get Out is the best film of 2017. Get Out is one of the most original horror films to come out in a very, very long time. In an age where the slasher villain and the demon possession and the ghost possession just run rampant through cinema, Get Out is one that doesn't deal with, you know, it doesn't deal with a ghost being the evil presence. It doesn't deal with a demon being an evil presence. It deals with one of the most ancient forms of evil ever, racism. Racism is the villain in this one. Racism and hate and intolerance is the villain in this story, because it shows that, you know, there's still problems today in the 21st century with interracial dating. There's still conflict. There's still going to be this uneasiness, and that's really tragic, and Get Out, like, addresses that. I don't want to spoil it too much in case you haven't seen it, but it really is a very important movie, an important horror film, and just a wonderful movie all around. The performances are brutal and raw and just believable. I didn't expect Jordan Peele, who's a comedian, no less, to create just such an entertaining and important horror film, a horror movie. He goes from straight up laugh out loud comedy to this chilling, dark, creepy, fantasy-like horror film that's just really, it'll just turn you upside down. And it's just, it's powerful. And it's important, and it's a movie that will be studied and remembered like Jaws and Alfred Hitchcock's classic movies are remembered fondly today. And I totally love it. It has a lot of Stanley Kubrick vibes. It has a lot of Alfred Hitchcock vibes. And it's just, it's all unsettling. And it all leads to a final confrontation in the end, which I will not spoil because it's just far too great. And that is my list for the top 10 films of 2017. And make sure you subscribe for more new and exciting content. And once again, I thank you dearly for checking out the Dean's List.